Well, hello everyone and welcome to Insight with Political Tours and Beyond the Headlines. At age 16, Thomas Dworzak was traveling the world taking photographs in places such as Northern Ireland and Yugoslavia. Later, he covered the Chechen Wars, Kosovo, Iraq, Afghanistan, and the Rose Revolution in Georgia. He's viewed as one of the best news photographers of his generation. In 2017, he was elected president of Magnum, the world-renowned photo agency, a term he served until just this summer. Hello, Thomas, and welcome to Insight.
Hi, thanks a lot for having me.
And you are in Paris, and I think you've been there for all this period?
Been in Paris since March, early March.
Yeah. And in your neat cubbyhole there, working away?
My little apartment, walking up and down, going stir crazy. That's
okay. Well, we're going to have a great time here. We're going to have a look over your work, get some insight in some of the places you've been to and the events you've covered, but also to see how news photography and your own interests have changed. Coming up, we've got some short films that give us an oversight of your work. But just to start with, can I say it's an obvious question, really. I mean, why photography? Why conflict? And to some extent, earlier on, why war?
Well, I think it's out of my history. It's a simple, the answer is as simple as the question, I guess. It's I grew up in Western Germany in the 80s, which was probably, in a way, one of the dullest moments of human history. And it was a small town, was very well protected. But at the same time, we were at the, probably should have asked a shrink, probably, but we were at the edge. We were at the Iron Curtain, so there was this kind of looming sense of there could be a war, but it was very abstract. And then I think my family my grandfather got killed in World War II. The other half of my family were refugees from Czechoslovakia. So war was sort of in the family, but it was also the extreme, like the weird extreme, the big fear. So I think it was in a strange way, it was probably the, besides the fact that I really wanted to leave because it was a very, I felt I had to leave this small town, but it's also to sort of push it all the way for war was like, it was probably the most extreme opposite of what I grew.
Yeah. The opposite of what you were living. I think to some extent that was a bit like me, sort of getting away from your own sort of comfort zones from home. You studied languages and I was just counting, I was doing sort of looking on the internet and I think I counted 6, but you count less.
I only count the ones I'm really comfortable with. So, but I didn't study. But the thing is, I'd never studied properly. I was very focused on becoming a photographer from very early on. But I think one of the legs, sort of the security thing, was always that I felt I should also learn a language. I should study something. So if I totally fail as a photographer, at least I have the language. So.
And Russian was one of them. I know you studied Czech because of your own family history as well. But Russian, and that I think that took you to the Caucasus fairly on. Am I right in saying?
Yes. I mean, now looking back, it's sort of funny because I think I missed a little bit of the, because having grown up on the Iron Curtain, I had an extreme distaste for anything Eastern European. I really didn't like it. I was more interested in the Middle East and Africa. That's sort of my idea of being a photographer was. But it's kind of stupid to think like that in 1989. So, but it took me till like the end of 1990, I think, to finally overcome my reluctance to deal with Eastern Europe. So I missed out a little bit on that. And then I sort of made my way east. I mean, I went to Yugoslavia, I lived in Prague, I made my way, I was a little bit of studying, living there. I mean, I was very young at the time. So, and then, so I got to Moscow and, but I actually came late, sort of in this journalistic sense of, well, I came to Moscow in 1991, and so in a way there was already hundreds of freelance photographers, and so it wasn't nothing special anymore to be in Moscow. So I was pretty lost and I didn't get anywhere. And for the big difference for me became the Caucasus, so that I actually started traveling in the Caucasus and then sort of got hooked on the Caucasus and stayed in the Caucasus until the end of the 90s.
And it's an incredible period of time, incredible period of upheaval. And the photographs you took at that time are incredible. I mean, they're iconic. And in a second, we're going to see the first of 3 films here that highlight your work. And I think you're one of the few sort of international photographers who followed both Chechen wars, and they were gruesome. And I mean, I think you give an introduction to your film here, and then perhaps we can ask more questions about the photographs afterwards.
I mean, in a funny way, the book, I mean, the way I'm going to show things is in the, how they historically, chronically, the chronicle in that way, how they were made. But it actually took me until 2010 to finish my book on the Caucasus. So when I was there in the 90s, I was 20 years old. I always said, oh, I'm doing a book on the Caucasus. That's the only excuse I had. And nobody was checking on me. And it was like, I could survive. I was struggling, but it's as long as I didn't go back, I was there. So I sort of accumulated pictures and had a very ideal and very, well, very free period in a way I could do a lot of things. I mean, I was at the heart of a huge story. I sort of had it for myself, not entirely for myself, but but I think it was the only, it was definitely the only foreign photographer based in the Caucasus. And, but I also didn't have any professional restraints because I didn't have an agency or anything. So just had a little bit of money and survived. So, but then I had this, this is probably sort of the best stuff I've done in my life. I mean, everything else is fine, but it's not, this was a very early, very, very intense and very important thing. And, but I literally didn't know what to do with it. So, and I think, I mean, now I almost don't want to look at it as, oh, the first Chechen war, the second Chechen war, these political things. In a way, it had to sort of sit and sit like pickles in a jar, and like the pictures had to like mature or whatever. So what kind of saved my ass in the whole issue, in the whole exercise, was that when I got to Russia and the Caucasus, I studied Russian. I tried to start reading Russian literature, obviously. And I mean, Russian 19th century Russian literature is not extremely difficult to read. It's okay with it. Like, it's not that, I mean, modern stuff is much more complicated. And, so I discovered this incredible school of thought, which was like the Russian literature on the Caucasus, which was Tolstoy, Lermontov, Pushkin, that all of them had their Caucasus experience. I had my little German, pale Bavarian boy thing in the Caucasus, but I was pretty innocent when I was trying to become a photographer. So they had a similar experience, which was also totally overwhelmed by this intensity of the Caucasus and everything. So they had it, but being officers or military, so they kind of committed genocide during the day, and in the evening they wrote poems to the beauty of the people and the strength of the man and the beauty of the woman, or like the landscape and everything. So I went back in the 2000s. I went back to the literature, and basically the whole book is built around the literature of on the Caucasus. So I'm basically on some sort of, my thesis on the whole thing is that I feel that this whole, well, now it's so far away in a way, this post-Soviet, all the trouble of these wars, I mean, Chechnya was a bigger one, but Karabakh, all of them, in a way, it's all some sort of unresolved, sick Russian imperialism between love and hatred. Mm. And but it also, it feels like it was already, the seed for this was already in that period.
Yeah, period of history. It makes for a really,
that's how I put it all together. Film. So, I mean, I can show you.
It makes for a really powerful film. So we'll just draw that up now.
So I show you. So it's basically, and so the book is built around, and it's really, I almost kind of gave up on the power of photography. I mean, I chose the important pictures, but I really wanted, it's very important to look at the whole story is built through the literature. I mean, it's basically built through the quotes, and so it's in Russian, they're read out, but the English subtitles are, you can read them.
Right. Okay. Set back and view.
All right, and so I will share, I don't know.
Посматривал он еще на горы и небо, и ко всем его воспоминаниям, мечтам, принесших строгое чувство величайной тревоги. Жизнь его началась не так, как он ожидал, уезжая из Москвы, а неожиданно хорошо. Горы, горы, горы чулись во всем, что он думал. И переезда его на Кавказ также следствие его романтического фанатизма. Я уверен, что накануне отъезда он с отцом Скрителем говорил с мрачным видом какой-нибудь хорошенькой соседки, что он видит не так просто служить, но что ищет смерти, потому что... Межгорцы пленных наблюдал их веру, нравы, воспитание, любил их жизнь и простоту, гостеприимство, жажду брани, движение водных, быстроту и легкость ног и лад. Не может быть, сказал Путлер, не зная, что говорить. Но то война. Война, скрипнула Мария Дмитриевна. Какая война? Живые зовут и все. Мертвое тело с земле предать надо, они зубоскалят. Живорезы, право, повторила она. Весело жить в такой земле. Какое-то отрадное чувство разлито во всех моих жилах. Воздух чистый, свеж, как поцелуй ребенка. Солнце ярко, небо синее. Чего-то кажется больше. Зачем тут страсти, желания, сожаления? Подъезжая к лощине, увидел я необыкновенную картину. Под деревом лежал один из наших татарских бэков, раненый смертельно. Подле него рыдал мулинец. Мулла, стоя на коленях, читал молитвы. Умирающий бэк был чрезвычайно спокоен и неподвижно глядел на молодого своего. Ну, полно, полно, сказал Печорин, обняв его от ужаски. Неужели я не тот же? Что делать? Всякому свою дорогу. Удастся ли еще встретиться? Бог знает. Нет в мире человека, над которым прошедшее приобретало бы такую власть, как надо мной. Всякое напоминание о минувшей печали или радости болезненно ударяет в мою душу и извлекает из нее все те же звуки. Я глупо создан, ничего не забываю, ничего.
There we go.
Okay. Let's get this.
So one of the questions when I look at those photographs is, I know, for example, that there's a the photograph of the soldiers carrying the one chap on a sheet between them on that, that snowy village. That's taken, that one, that series won the World Press photo in, was it 2000
or 2001? 2001, yeah.
2001, yeah. And that was, I mean, the thing that I know is that for you, in order for you to stay alive during that, that was quite some feat. I mean, there was not a pretty experience. Can you just say what was happening there?
No, it's basically, it's the retreat. Oh, this is in a second, it's like halfway through the second Chechen War when the, so for a couple of months, the Chechen resistance had kept Grozny. So they were holding Grozny. And so I was with the journalist. I was actually working as a translator at the time. So the journalist that I was working with, she really wanted to go to Grozny. So the way in was this one village I knew through my contacts. And what happened was the moment we arrived, basically the day we arrived in that village, the Chechens had decided to abandon Grozny. So they came out in three waves over 3 days, almost three nights. And but they were lured into a minefield. So when I went with a small group, I went back closer to Grozny. I sort of went in and out, but I didn't go. I mean, obviously I couldn't go back all the way, but it was a very gruesome scene. And then they left there. And then they sort of dispersed into the mountains. And it was, in a way, this was the end of the sort of the classic war in Chechnya. I mean, it wasn't it really became a guerrilla war where they kept territories in the mountains, but they had to give up the capital. So.
And what was the access like? Because I know it became increasingly difficult for photographers and outsiders to cover that.
Second war was very difficult. The first war was great. It was like, I was like a fish in the water because I could speak the language. I could get around.
If you can say a war is great.
But access-wise, you said that. So I think it was in a very human way. It was a very natural and normal way how I like engaged with people and everything. It was like I've never found anything similar in that way. I think also the sort of general acceptance, even with the Russians a little bit. I mean, I didn't work a lot on the Russian side, but it was even there was still there was some sort of neutrality one could sail on. And the second one was, well, between the two wars, kidnapping started. So kidnappings became this huge issue. And so my security suddenly became this big issue, big thing. So I couldn't, that's what I had to think about all the time. So for a group of fighters to take me, before I wasn't specifically with one group or with somebody. I lived with an old Cossack woman, and I would go out, hang out with a few guys and walk around. I hitchhiked a lot around Chechnya, and it was totally fine. I mean, it was like, this wasn't the... And then it went totally the other way around. And so I had to have security. I had like a whole group that would take responsibility for me, blah, blah, blah. So the whole thing. So it became extremely frustrating. And I think that's also what sort of killed a lot of the relations we had, because every step you had to think about.
And you worked in black and white for a lot of that decade, didn't you?
I was very, I mean, I was upset. I wouldn't allow a color film into my camera until like 1999 or something. I think it was, I thought it was sacrilegious too. Well, I sometimes was encouraged to shoot slide for like illustrations or whatever.
What, one of my favorite photographs, and I would dig it out here, but maybe I'll dig it up towards the end, is the photograph of a guy jumping into a pool on a sort of semi-destroyed balcony into a swimming pool, and he's just stuck in midair, and there's another guy walking to the camera. And if it was in color, I don't think it would have worked, but the fact that it was in black and white made it really, really vivid.
But it's also the truth. It's the danger of black and white. I mean, I think God bless Russian literature, I think, because I think if it had, I would not want to do one of these nostalgic touched album. I mean, it is, of course there's nostalgia if I look at the pictures, and it is nostalgic now, but now I think it would be very complicated. I think even like philosophically, it's very complicated to take these kind of pictures that appeal to us because they have this form of all the like, and it's like, okay, I had to stop as well. So now I'm almost, I haven't shot black and white in 15 years or something. I mean, I'm very, anti-like.
There's another photo, and we'll move on in just a second to something much more colourful. And that there's a photograph, there was a group of women, and there's a woman in a very pretty dress, and she's turning around, and there's a Kalashnikov hanging over her shoulder. Where was that? What was the story behind that?
It's in the, I think it was the, well, the First Chechen War kind of ended after the Budionovsk hospitals take over by the Shamil Bisayev and a bunch of Chechen rebels, whatever, terrorists for the Russians, obviously, took hostages in a hospital, and it became a very gruesome and bloody incident. But it also led to the withdrawal of the Russian troops. That's what they negotiated. So they actually, so in 96, there was like this August 96. Well, the war was over. This was like the they had gotten what they wanted, and the Russians pulled out. So this was a celebration for that. It was like in Shamil Basayev's hometown, I think.
I don't know. I want to show more of the photographs, and we've very kindly shared some photos with us some time back, and I don't know if we can share some of those with your permission later, if anyone wants to see more of those. But the next thing we're going to look at is actually.
Does anybody have any? I mean, maybe we should have quite. I don't know. I mean, two people in LA who got up at 3 o'clock in the morning.
We can come back. If anyone's got any questions about that now, we can certainly take theirs. But
because it's going to break up a little bit. I mean, it's going to be a little.
Yeah. I don't know. I think what we'll do is we'll keep your question. If you've got questions about the Caucasus, the Kavkaz bit, do note them down. Start writing them up. But I think what we'll do is we'll move on to the next section, which is Afghanistan and the Taliban, and we make a very dramatic jump or move away from black and white, and even a move away from Thomas's own photography. Thomas explains.
Anyway, no, so yeah, so but by the end of the 90s, I mean, I kind of knew I had to start. I mean, I had to do something else. I had to leave the Caucasus somehow. And so I left, and then I moved to Paris for a while, and it was pretty messy. I mean, didn't really know what I was doing.
For a while during that period, you were there in 99 and also a bit after 2000, later on after your Chechen.
Yeah, no, but then I went to Kosovo for like a year and a half, more or less, and covered that. And in Kosovo, I became a professional photographer because I changed from, I mean, it's a very stupid detail, but it was sort of the first time you could buy portable scanners and I could shoot color neg. It was like, it was as simple as that. That's what made me from somebody who had photographed into a pocket for 8 years and never shared any pictures because I couldn't afford the shipping or anything. Suddenly I could send JPEG attachments. So, but I think it was disastrous for photography. I think the whole technical thing that our life was turned into the life of an electrician and technicians, whatever. So I don't think I did anything particularly. It was good. It was news. It was normal. Kosovo, but I didn't have any space for to do something else. And after the fall of Grozny and with all of this, well, I got into Magnum. So I don't know how many of you know about it. It's the oldest and a very prestigious agency, and there's a very strict, very very complicated admission process that goes over 4 years. And so the funny thing was that also I was really somebody who would like learn a language and then read a book and then maybe take a picture after 3 months. I suddenly was perceived as this young guy with the scanner who was sort of sent off to cover all these wars and everything, which I wasn't extremely, it wasn't the wars wasn't the problem, but the whole speed of it was very weird. And also the first years there was nothing. And then September 11 happened, of course. So that became the watershed moment for me, which was like there was a whole explosion of interest in photography. And so I basically sailed on that. There's nothing original about it to go to Afghanistan after September 11. I mean, hundreds and hundreds of journalists did that. And the same way how then this whole kind of post-September 11 circus moved on to Iraq. So those were the two big stories that I did through the 2000s until almost like 2008, 2009. And then, funnily, so actually the first book I did and the first, I mean, I never, because I had this Caucasus in my neck, which was like the real thing. It was like the serious thing. The Chechens was like people I felt comfortable with and I could talk to and everything. So I always, I had quite a distance to everything I did. And I would have never even thought about that I would do a book on Afghanistan because I thought I had nothing to, this was just like what everybody else did as well. So, but what happened was that in early 2002, I was in Kandahar, and the southern big city, which was the was sort of the capital of the Taliban movement, and they had just about been chased away by the anti-Taliban alliance and the Americans. And I was walking around, like literally walking around the hotel, I stumbled across photo studios which had pictures of the Taliban. And so, I mean, I can, it's basically, I can tell you the thing, but it's also, the clip is like, it's pretty interesting because Ahmed Rashid talks in the thing. He's one of the big, or he's like the number one scholar on the Taliban as a Pakistani academic. And so he explains it a little bit, but basically well, we'll look a little bit, and then I think once it's all
Let's look first, because once you've seen it,
we're I don't need to explain. I mean, it's sort of meant to be understandable.
Yeah.
From the clip thing.
This is very interesting.
But just again, these are not my pictures. It's just stuff I found in a box. So I cannot claim anything except having saved them from the trash bin. And
here we go.
The Taliban would actually destroy any figure, and that meant human figure, animal figure, any figure which they said was created by God and therefore could not be depicted. Now, this led to some pretty bizarre things, like, for example, if you had a mannequin in a shop, you would have to chop its head off, deforming traffic signals, but even going into the Kabul Museum and chopping off the faces of statues which were 5,000 years old. So you would go into the Kabul Museum and you see all these incredibly old statues with their heads chopped off. And that was pretty depressing, I can tell you. The Taliban then insisted that for passports, men would have their photographs and women would have their fingerprints. This was not allowed in many countries, obviously. Anyway, they allowed some students to open, ostensibly to take passport photographs. And these studios then started taking clandestine pictures of young Taliban.
I didn't take these pictures. I found them and I want to make them public because I think they're great. Because a lot of people thought that was my way of representing the Taliban, that I went to Afghanistan, photographed the Taliban and made them look like Gilbert and George gay icons, which they chose to do it themselves. So I got a lot of criticism in Europe from the sort of liberal PC left who found it demeaning for me to make them look like this. They chose to look like that.
These images are very, very typical of the kind of pictures that people are taking today. People will go to a studio and the pictures will be very staged and there will be makeup and you'll brush your hair, do your turban. You know, there's this air of mystery about them simply because these studios were only semi-legal. These pictures were not permissible. And these young men, you know, are showing affection to each other. You know, at that time, all this was illegal.
It was a couple of weeks after the Taliban were kicked out of Kandahar by the anti-Taliban alliance, supported by the Americans. Opposite of the hotel was a whole row of photo studios who were about to reopen because they had been banned under the Taliban. So now they're like cleaned out the windows and put up their new signs. It was this sort of life restoring again after the departure of the Taliban. And so I saw these pictures. I just saw them in the window, went up to them and asked if I could see more of them, if I could buy them or if I could take them. And they weren't very happy to give them to me. They didn't understand why I was interested. And they felt like some stupid Westerner wants these stupid pictures. It's a very feminine culture. They're very feminine with their old black eyeliner and their little guns and their flowers and their holding hands and everything.
There is a very strong homosexual tradition in which an older man will kind of adopt a young man and become lover come student and teach him whatever skills he may have. The Taliban leader, Mullah Muhammad Omar, attacked and killed a warlord who was keeping young boys as his concubines. And in fact, that move was the start of the Taliban movement. It was a movement against oppression. So one of the first things Mullah Omar did was to ban homosexuality. But in fact, I mean, given the sort of long-standing traditions of this in southern Afghanistan, this continued. But it was done very surreptitiously because the Taliban had very strict rules about it. Tribesmen wear a lot of coal in the eyes, and actually it has a lot of health benefits because coal protects you from the glare of the sun, and it also protects you in dust storms from the eye being damaged by grit. So traditionally, nomads and tribesmen have worn a lot of coal. Secondly, Afghan nomads wear their hair very long, which is also a tradition. And thirdly, I mean, Afghans love having their pictures taken. And certainly, if you remember the 1980s during the war against the Soviets, no Afghan would hesitate to have his picture taken with his gun and etc. And but they would always kind of try and do themselves up. They comb their beard, they comb their hair, they tie their turban properly. They were always very self-conscious, even in the 80s. And that tradition has continued.
Okay, I mean, this is,
yeah,
goes on a little bit longer, but that's sort of the key. Okay.
But it really interests me, Thomas, because in a way, when you started off, we talked about the black and white, we talked about the Caucasus, and you talked about how you've moved away from that. And in a way, this is what you've moved towards much more now, which is sort of documenting society. And that doesn't necessarily mean you stepping out and taking photographs yourself. So can you talk just a bit about that shift?
I think that's it. The Taliban was really happening in a very crude and simple way. It was just like this really non-concept. There was no concept or anything. I just came across this, and I truly believe that those pictures are more interesting than what I did. I mean, it's like, I don't want to diminish what I did. It was fine. It was photojournalism that was necessary. But I mean, I'm as a viewer, I'm more curious about this kind of stuff in a way. Because there's a certain innocence to it. I don't know, everybody bitches about selfies now. I think I like selfies a lot because I think there's a lot in the selfie. There's a lot of sort of hidden truth in a selfie that's maybe not in the perfect thought of portrait by a portrait photographer. It's not always there because it's also so, well, we're so much photographers. I think for me, it's one of my biggest problems is I think I'm too much a photographer, I think. I think photography is something relatively stupid, I think. Sort of, it's limited. There are a lot of things. There are things you can't...
It's become so rehearsed, it's lost a sort of an original...
I feel like my own, like now the cameras are getting better and better, and it's almost like sort of, you have this incredible technical, and I know so well how to do the first foreground and the background and everything, this kind of perfect picture stuff, but it automatically excludes so many other things that don't fit into that, that don't happen that way because the light was the other way around. So that's sort of that's what I'm saying, photography is stupid, it's exaggerated, but mm-hmm. Is this what I really think, this is where I get angry and I'm like, this is so stupid. Why is it? Because it doesn't make a picture. At the same time, I don't want to change anything. I'm totally old fashioned as a photographer. I'm totally classic. I don't want to move anything. I don't want to interfere. I don't have the creativity to interfere. But it's also for me that hunt for the right picture is what makes real photography makes it interesting. Yeah. So I don't want to give up on that. And so I find myself in collecting a lot, and I've done a lot of collecting, and I'm using. I don't mind limitations in that way. Sort of something that's.
Well, we'll come on to more of that in a second. If everyone can start asking their questions, so if you write, you put your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom here, and then we'll come to those questions in it very shortly. The next thing we're going to look at, and we don't have time for all of it, we've got a time for a short amount of it, really is very much going the other way again now. This really is sort of documenting, you know, very much a sort of classic war photography. and that's in Iraq. And again, you've chose to juxtapose it with a story that we're all familiar with as well, Thomas.
Well, it's again, because I think, look, I sort of continued on that, in that circus of we all moved to Iraq because Iraq was the big conflict and there was hundreds of photographers. And I think I had my thing. I did what I had to do. It's totally fine. But again, I did not feel this was a particular personal journey or anything. So what happened with Iraq was, well, A, there was this, it was this strange discovery of America because I didn't know the U.S. very well. So I spent more time in embeds than in the U.S. proper. So, I mean, I kind of had
this. You being, going on to U.S. camps, joining U.S. military units, and then
possibly. Exactly. So, I mean, this is, there's a whole discussion now of this, whatever, if this was the right or the wrong or whatever has come out of this. I'm generally very defensive of it because I think I was able to do something that that wasn't textbook propaganda or anything. So I didn't feel particularly controlled. I felt much more taken care of than in a lot of other conflicts where you'd also embed, but it's just sort of sucking up to somebody's grandmother instead of signing a paper.
But we might be familiar with the terminology, but people watching might not be. Embed means you're basically being accepted by a military unit and attached to them and for your assignment.
So they take care of you. You live with them. There are certain limitations. There were legal limitations. One of them was that you couldn't publish pictures of injured or deceased soldiers before their next of kin was informed. But it wasn't that you couldn't do it in general. So which is a very important difference to make. So. But okay, but still, from a sort of, I don't know, I mean, I'm kind of started photography on the street. I mean, I still struggled with the idea of having to deal with the structure, having to be in this thing. So, and especially since the big, in the 2000s, the big problem or the big issue in Iraq were car bombs, actually. It was this kind of civil war-ish car bombs between the Shias and the Sunnis and that. And it was absolutely uncovered in a way because you couldn't get there. I mean, there was this, like, some media organization had huge security details. Others were dressing up like whatever, but nobody really met. It was like you couldn't. It was extremely difficult to work on it. So in a very, very unsportsy and, like, I mean, I felt I'm like totally throwing all my values out of the window with like proper journalism is, I actually decided to embed with the medical unit, which is like, it's about the human equivalent of riding an ambulance, which is as low as it can get, I think, as a journalist. I mean, you don't want to be the one that rides on the ambulance. Either you go, you put yourself out there, or you do. And I really, but I, in a cynical way, I thought this is the way that's going to get me to these places. So I wasn't interested in the medic people. I wasn't interested in any of this. I just thought that's sort of my transport to the car bomb, like in a stupid way. And I started the embed, and it's like these embeds are extremely time consuming. I mean, you spend hours and hours and days sitting around. So what a lot of people do this time is you watch video, you watch movies on your laptop, you read or you watch, but then you can't read that much because the light wasn't that good. Literally, it's like sort of nonstop watching. So usually they stream in these little places where they have TV, they have like American Idol nonstop until everybody gets like really stupid. And so a friend of mine, and the funny thing was, in Iraq, Amazon worked very well. So you could actually, among photographers, we would send each other gifts through Amazon because it's being delivered to military units. So if you know what unit somebody in, you could send them. So a friend of mine sent me a 12-pack of MASH. He said, oh, you were the medics. Here we go. This is like, he sent me the 12-season package of MASH. And because I was sitting on an airfield, basically waiting for my moment to jump on a helicopter and fly off to document some casualty incident, it was very noisy. So I turned on the hearing aid for the hard of hearing, like this sort of, I turned on the subtitles. And I started watching, MASH. So I did know, remotely knew about MASH when I was a kid, but it really is not part of my culture. I mean, I didn't grow up on MASH or anything. So I started watching it and increasingly became very, very fascinated by it because it, suddenly, especially these sort of subtitle things had, where suddenly there's this stuff. So MASH, it's interesting. And I'm not talking, the movie is great and it's a wonderful art house movie, the Robert Altman one, everything. What I'm talking about is the series. So the series was filmed during the Vietnam War. It's Korea during the Korean War. But apparently, like, some of the actors speak Vietnamese just to screw the whole thing up a little bit. So the actors and the directors who made the movie were very liberal, anti-war, left-leaning, and everything. The studio bosses were like thick-necked, right-wing, whatever. And so what I heard is that they had actually parallel scripts. So they gave some scripts to the studio guys to sign off on, and then they would improvise and do something. So if you look at MASH, it's half of it is absolutely totally silly. It's like hot lead Huna hips and whatever, like this whole stuff. It's like Klinger is falling into a trench and dressing up as a woman. And the other half is absolute heavy, serious life and death. What are we doing here? Like all these big questions.
And that's the same juxtaposition of you being on those bases where you have, you know, McDonald's, you've got screens, you can, you know, order what you like. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly you go outside and there's Iraq on the street and it's completely different. We're keen to get people's questions to you as well. So we'll run this for a few minutes.
No, anyways, I just put it together. So basically, what's important is I think that this is kind of what brought me to the Caucasus. Because if I actually, you know, chronologically, I did MASH before I did. So MASH was the first time when I like aggressively used text as the storytelling line. So yeah. I photographed my screen. I had thousands of quotes, and then I made a book.
You made this film first, like you were saying before.
I made the book, yeah, but all of these films, each one of them led to a book. So they're like film versions of books. But that's what sort of made me do it. And in the end, I'm like, I really thought I had a harder time editing out the quotes because there were so many great MASH quotes. I was like,
Okay.
And so I'll run like one segment. It's like, it's three different segments, but it's kind of, I mean, you get an idea. And it can be watched.
So everyone start, while we're doing this, start getting your questions here. And we can go back to any sort of...
Okay.
Yeah.
So the music is actually the MASH theme by Manic Street Preachers. But I couldn't... The other, we couldn't get the original. It was like, there's a copyright issue.
Yeah. So everyone get writing your questions while we're queuing this up, and then we can come to those questions straight after this section of film.
Vision type of things to be, the things that I will help for me. I realize that I can't see that suicide is painless. It takes a man to change it. I think I will think it all. That game of life is hard to play. I'm gonna use it anyway. The losing card or some delay. So this is all I have to say. Let's see who is sad as painless. It brings a man to change it. I can take a minute if I believe. The sign of time will be a sign. It doesn't help when effect ends, but as it works its way on in, aimless sun will watch it rain. Let's see who is not as famous. There's a man to change us. I can take anything if I please. I breathe my lungs to rest at me. To ask a question that I can. That's it to be or not to be. I'm
Thomas, we were talking earlier in this series. We had Andrew Tester here, and he was saying that one of the things that had frustrated him during this whole period at the moment about COVID was the difficulty he had in actually covering people who were dying. And we had some strong reactions from some of the people who are watching. We were saying, you know, why the hell should he be in hospitals? Why the hell should you be in morgues showing that side of things? And Andrew's argument was, and this was also echoed by some other people, is that we're living in lockdown is only half the story. You know, a big part of the story is actually the people who are dying. I presume that's your take as well.
Well, yes, but not even only the lockdown, I think in general. I mean, I think we're living in a total Western hypocrisy that as long as it's like Rwandans piled up on a truck, we want to see the pictures. If it's white people, we don't want to see it. So I think there's sort of a gradual acceptance of death. So death is not accepted if it's... look, the funny thing is I've got a lot of criticism, though you're in bed so much, you hang out with the American soldiers all the time. There are the pictures of American soldiers dying, and I've taken them legally under the embed agreement. They weren't published in the US. Okay, but they also weren't published in Europe. So everybody who's like sort of having this European outrage of, oh, the Americans are censoring journalists when you go, it's much tougher now. It's much more complicated now than it was at the time. But at the time it was like, I mean, I want to see what they were done. What's happened on COVID? What has been published in France? People have photographed funerals in France for COVID and nobody wants to publish it because we don't want to spoil people's breakfast. I mean, this whole confinement stuff is bullshit. I think it's total. I mean, it's like, oh, yes, well, poor creative sitting at home doesn't know how to do juggling anymore. I mean, it's like, no, COVID is about people. It's like, yes.
Yeah. And yeah. Have you, I mean, I know Franklin, I'm sorry, I've forgotten your colleague's name here in London. He's done quite a bit of work, and unusually, he's actually got access to hospitals and being able to photograph that side of things. So you've clearly, Magnum has been able to do some of this.
No, people have been able to do. I think that it is very difficult because there are all kinds of restrictions, and mostly it's about privacy and dignity and everything. And like, I don't want to take any, but like really, I think we're all in a war, wherever it is, we're all, I mean, any self-respecting photographer is going to try to be very, very dignified, to walk that line that is complicated, to go into somebody's house where somebody has just died or whatever, like to deal with this. But it's also, there is a sort of a general, well, that we think this is important. And if it's not for right now, then it's for history, then it is. And there are ways of doing it. I mean, there's like, I don't know. I think my feeling here, it is it's not done for the wrong reasons.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not done for reasons of sort of sanitizing reality. So,
Stuart Franklin was the name I was trying to remember. Who's done a lot of good work on this. Let's start taking some questions. So Simon Jackson, if you're there, we'll just unplug that, open that microphone up, and it could be Simon or Annie. Sometimes it's Annie McMahon disguised as Simon. Who is it this time?
It's me.
Yeah, Annie.
Which is a pity because Simon's actually the photographer of the family. But I was curious about your experience in photographing people in both the Caucasus and Afghanistan. Did you find people very sensitive about being photographed and it being an exception when people were happy to be photographed, or were generally people much more comfortable about it?
I mean, definitely in the Caucasus, I felt to be totally at ease, sort of floating in the group. But it's also, I have a way of hanging out with people. It's very, I'm close to them sort of physically, and I kind of looked the part. So it helps. This was the Caucasus this sort of like the 1990s Caucasus for me was, for example, was a huge difference walking around the streets in the Caucasus or walking around in Moscow. It wasn't just Soviet Union. There was a clear, it was so much easier and so much more, generally accepted. I mean, it was okay to be a foreign photographer. Okay. Afghanistan as well, not particularly difficult. I mean, one would think with the religious restrictions, of course, I never tried to photograph, I don't know, I haven't been close to any Taliban. And so I don't know what that would have felt like. But but generally, no, it's okay. I think it's, I mean, now I feel it's, the acceptance of photography is like decreasing in huge steps all across the world in every kind of culture. It's getting harder. Like the sort of, the more people take pictures of themselves all the time and everything, it's like, it becomes, yeah. I find the West actually more complicated, the so-called Western world.
Yeah. I want to take people back a bit. One of the things we haven't spoken about is, you spoke a bit about Georgia, but also Mikhail Saakashvili, and there's somebody who did give you a huge amount of access. And I don't know if, would you allow me to share that photograph of Saakashvili on the bus? I think I might be able to dig that up. I don't know if, Isabel, can you find that one while we're talking? So this is a moment in history where, Thomas, you say, but clearly Saakashvili, who likes to have control over things, feels that the bus driver is not doing a sufficient job.
No idea what we're talking about. But it's like, and I agree with the rest of what you're saying.
Rose Revolution.
Okay.
And Saakashvili taking over a bus, literally driving, I think he was driving to Parliament in order to sort of storm it and take it over.
He's in the bus. He's sitting in a bus. If that's the one you're talking about?
Yeah, yeah.
He's sitting in a bus. No, this was the Rose Revolution. This one. Oh, no, he's not driving. He's just talking on the phone. It was like CNN or some journalist. But that's a long, that's the old story of, that was sort of a small side excursion from my hanging out in Iraq and Afghanistan all the time. So I did occasionally go back to Georgia, and I've kept very strong relations, of course. And I always thought I would go back to Georgia eventually, or back to the Caucasus, but way later. So when the war happened in 2008, I went, but I thought, okay, I'm going to go, I cover it, and then I'm out of there. And but then I got to know the president at the time, and it's almost kind of got stuck with him. I mean, it was like this. So we did a book on just sort of the modern Georgia. I stayed on being his quote unquote personal photographer, and it was a very interesting, a very intense time. It wasn't something I had planned, and it wasn't something I would have ever really thought I would be doing, but I thought it was the right thing at the right time. I think when I was getting older, I wasn't running around as fast anymore for the wars and everything. So.
Yeah,
but
he's certainly a character to follow. I remember interviewing him. I think it was Dubrovnik, and he did. He, unlike anybody else, he didn't give the impression of being a politician and being offhand. He really liked the company of journalists, and he spent a very long time over lunch with us. I remember that.
It's interesting. I mean, it was the thing I kind of regret, because still, I mean, it wasn't, it's still Georgia. It's a small country. The funny thing was, Georgia at the time was sort of A-list. So what he did was like, he did these A-list trips to like meeting. He was always at these big international meetings, and the only country besides like whatever UK, US, Germany, whatever, was like Georgia. Okay, so he got himself in there, but there was because of his, I don't know, like flamboyance, I think there was, it almost distracted, because I was actually interested, I was really interested in this, what are sort of the signs of power, how does this work, almost the boring part of it, sort of the administration, the legal, that this machinery that runs a state. And with him, it wasn't like that, because it was like this kind of roller coaster of, yeah.
He was like a rock. He was more of a rock star than a politician. I mean, he had an enormous ego.
No. It was like, yeah. It wasn't very conventional. Let's put it that way.
Diane Cook, you've got a question, Diane Cook. Diane, I think we're just there. We go. I think you should. There we go. There we go. We got you there. Go on. You need to unmute your microphone. So you just need to go up to the there. Yeah, you go. Yeah. That's it. Now I can hear you.
You can hear me now. Okay.
Yes.
Good. Yeah. Can remember the question. Were you just now saying that given that we can, there are the amount of pictures we can take have exploded exponentially with the smartphone, that we're actually inured to pictures? We don't get as much shock out of them as perhaps those pictures from Vietnam and Korea and so on in the past did?
I don't know. Like, I think it's definitely passing by faster. I think sort of this, like the amount of outrage over something goes and then it comes and then it goes again. I mean, it's like, doesn't like look at Vietnam pictures. There's still the icons of those handful of pictures. There was, now there are many more of them. So I think that's what I was referring to, was just the general amount of people taking pictures, which is for me, it's a very strange correlation that almost everybody is taking pictures all the time. And if you're perceived as being a professional photographer or doing something, you're sort of a weirdo or a pervert, or they don't like you. But photography is socially, it's acceptable if it's not on a phone, and it's totally fine. You sit at a dinner. If I take out a camera at a dinner now, there's going to be two people who are going to be really weird about it. Just at a dinner, like 10 years ago, this was kind of funny. Yeah, like whatever, you're the photographer. Oh, you take a few pictures for you. Like on a very banal things. Whereas everybody has the capacity to do this. I mean, I've been in situations where everybody takes pictures with a phone and I come with a camera and they go after me. I mean, it's like...
So it's almost like it's become part of... Your phone has become part of you as a person, but that person over there who's got a proper camera is different.
Well, that's the... Yeah, people don't want to be... I don't know. But then also you have a thing, I have to defend myself being the professional, and then it actually helps. Then you get a little bit of you're sort of, okay, well, I'm not like... Mm. But I think I find, especially in sort of in the Western world, I find it very complicated. I find it very strange how... I mean, I get yelled at by people who are at photo exhibitions.
Yeah.
Go.
I miss the sort of classic photography. I think in the sort of, because we have so much social media around us, there seems to be less room for the really good photography. Can we just, I think we can bring up that photograph of the one I was mentioning much earlier in the discussion of the guy jumping into the pool. So this is the photograph I was talking about.
Okay.
Which, and I want to talk about this briefly and then talk about the stuff you're doing now, Thomas. So where was this? I love this photo.
This is in Sukhumi. It's the breakaway Russian occupied part of Georgia. And I went there a lot early, in my early years in the Caucasus. I used to go, I spent a lot of time there, and it was like this sort of abandoned. It used to be the jewel of the Soviet Union. It was like the seaside resort. Everybody was everybody was fighting to get like vouchers to go spend their Soviet holidays there. And then it got caught up in this devastating war. And then the Abkhaz and the Russians kicked out 300,000 Georgians. So it became pretty depopulated after the war. And now it's this, it's different now, but at the time it was like this almost sort of nature had taken back over, ruins with grass and palm tree. Like, yeah.
Yeah. That's cute. Isabel, can we cue left or right just to see there's just a couple of other examples from that period, I think. Don't know if it's easy for you to do. I don't know if it's easy. Maybe it may not be. But contrast that just with what you're doing at the moment, Thomas, because you've been really looking at the more virtual world, particularly as we've been in lockdown, haven't you?
I mean, it's not. I've been early on in the COVID, I basically decided that I'm not going to go outside because I figured there was enough people doing hospital pictures, and there was enough. I thought sort of empty Paris was very impressive and very nice, but it didn't really. I mean, how many pictures of single people with masks can you take? So in a way, I also felt that was something was going on, and I thought it was a bit. The challenge was, how am I going to be able to address this? So I decided to take pictures of Zoom meetings. So I've been basically photographing for the last 4 months. I've photographed a lot of Zoom, so a little bit of Skype, a little bit of WhatsApp, whatever, but it's mostly Zoom sort of being the tool of the age. And so it took me a while, because at the beginning I thought I should be more proactive. So I was trying to set up situations, have people go somewhere and show me something, which is all, none of it didn't work. So now I'm doing it in a totally passive way. I basically contact people and I ask if I can have access, if I can participate, if I can take pictures. And it's religious events, counseling, education, parties. I don't know, name it. I mean, there's a lot of political activism on Zoom happening. And so it's, I don't know yet what I mean. I'm still shooting a little bit. And I'm sort of wanting to stop at the 1st of July as I've got my end date for it. I can't totally stop because in the US, especially in the US, there's still a lot going on. And so I don't know what's going to happen with the second wave. And
yeah,
this is what it is. But it's, of course, extremely limited because there's nothing I can really do. It's all control Apple 3. I mean, I'm taking screenshots of my screen. So.
Control, say it again. So you're literally taking scene screenshots on your computer.
That's it.
Right. Wow. But I mean, it shows you how much has changed because you essentially now see your role. You are trying to document life. I mean, you've shifted away from being a classic photographer doing war photography to somebody who's really trying to capture the reality that we're all experiencing.
I still want to do it. I still want to do normal quote unquote photography, but I also think, a little bit my justification and my credibility comes out of this that I have done it. I mean, I think I would feel it to be a gimmick if I would do a Pashto council meeting in Kandahar on Zoom. But since I've done the real ones 3 times or something, it's okay. I think it's fine. It's like I feel like I can.
Yeah. And then even to, you've coming back to the Zoom bit, that it, you've also caught Zoom bombing as well. Which I've
figured what I did. I had a commission from a cultural institution to do this. My loose project was, and I don't know if I'm totally going to stick to it, was that I will basically I'm recreating about a dozen of roles photographers traditionally have. So I would be the political protocol photographer. I would be the social reportage photographer. I would be a wedding photographer. So I photograph weddings. I would be a funeral photographer. I photograph funerals. And so one of the fashion photographers do some fashion. And the the war photographer, I figured should be Zoom bombing. So I have covered Zoom bombings from both sides. I've spent endless hours waiting for Zoom bombers to bomb. And I have spent as long and as equally endless hours, but as more efficiently actually tagging along with little Zoom bombers when they go Zoom bombing. And kind of funny. I mean, it's not very serious.
A lot of time and dedication to do it. We're going to wrap up very shortly, but I do want to share some of the... Are you okay, Thomas, if I share some of the photographs from the early period? Isabel, if we could just bring up some of those photos there. Here we go. So just because I don't want to end without some people seeing me. So many of these photographs were used in the film, but it just...
Well, that's all in the film. Yeah, that's all in the
Caucasus. In the film, yeah. Yeah. We'll go on to the next one. That was just one. There we go. I think we have to go. Is this in Gori? It looks like, where is this?
That's
in
Gori, yeah. It's the old Stalin statue.
It's Stalin's museum, which is still there.
Stalin's hometown and museum.
Yeah, it's just still there.
Statue's gone. I mean, they kind of took it off.
They've put some sort of weird creche or something, some kind of reconstruction of his house in front of it.
That's his natural, the little farmhouse he grew up in is there as a...
It's there, yeah, that's it. Yeah. Yeah.
And
I don't think we've got a slide, so we just have to go through one by one. Well, listen, Thomas, it's been really, really good talking to you. I can't see more questions being asked at the bottom there. And we go to an hour. We've just gone over an hour. So it's been a really good discussion. Thank you very much. I'm just going to tell everyone what's coming up next. We're going to announce August's program very shortly. The next talk we have is on Tuesday the 4th, and that's with Efraim Zuroff from the Simon Wiesenthal Center. Efraim is, you'd call him, I think, a Nazi hunter. He's written several books, and his latest book is called Our People. And it's really about the Holocaust in the Baltics, and more specifically Lithuania. And it's co-written with a Lithuanian journalist who's actually descendant of people who took part in those attacks, those pogroms. It's a gripping book, and the talk will be very, very interesting. So that's at 1 p.m. UK time next Tuesday, August the 4th. And again, we'll be sending out our program for August very shortly. My thanks again to Thomas. It's been a really, really good discussion. Thank you very much indeed for giving up your time and also sharing your videos with us. Thank you very much and goodbye.
Thanks. Bye-bye.